Thank you so much for being here, and a very, very warm welcome to all of you. My name is Mini Mathur, and I welcome you all to India's first Cinema Summit, brought to you exclusively by Dainik Jagran, India's largest read daily. Yes, there's no GST on audience applause. Come on. It's going to be a fantastic session, a fantastic half day that all of you, and I hope all of you are going to be staying long enough to enjoy it. Dainik Jagran is a group that believes in creating and promoting a culture of cinema appreciation. And all their initiatives, like the Jagran Film Festival, the Jagran Cinema Summit, attempt to enhance and celebrate cinematic influences. Ladies and gentlemen, the Indian film industry is, as you all know, on the cusp of a lot of changes. Exciting new writers are coming in, newer, bolder themes are being explored, new technology in filmmaking is making our movies really cutting edge. The contours of the business of cinema are undergoing a dramatic shift as well. And our industry needs an open platform such as this to discuss and debate these exciting, daunting changes. The Jagran Cinema Summit is an initiative by the Jagran Group to fulfill this extremely critical gap, and I hope we'll succeed in addressing some of these issues by the end of the evening. Ladies and gentlemen, first things first, we are all here today as an industry of really proud cinema makers, and there is no event that is possible without an auspicious lighting of the lamp. So I'd now like to request one of the finest filmmakers for me in the world, Mr. Shekhar Kapoor, to please come up on stage and light the lamp. I'd also like to call Mr. Ajay Brahmatmaj, the entertainment editor of Jagran, Mr. Basant Rathore, senior vice president of the Jagran Group, and the lovely Ms. Kangana Ranaut to come on stage and lighten. And of course, getting them all here, Mayank Shekhar, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, this is not just a photo op. You can put your hands together and let's just hope to have a fantastic, auspicious, fruitful debate tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, a warm round of applause, and we have begun on this auspicious note. Thank you so much, gentlemen, Kangana. The photographers were just like, Kangana ji left, dekhiye, Kangana ji right, dekhiye. Yeah. Thank you, gentlemen. I'd now like to request Mr. Basant Rathore to stay back and give us a few words of wisdom. Yes. well, Mr. Rathor will be back, but I really want to call on stage. Like I said, he's one of the finest filmmakers the industry has seen on in India as well as the global platform. He really needs no introduction, so I'm not going to bother with one. Please welcome for our keynote address today on the future of film, Mr. Shekhar Kapoor on stage.
Thank you. Hi, how are you? I thought Kangana was going to be on stage with me. No? Do you want to come? No? Okay, all right. So the question that I've been asked is, what is the future of... What? Okay. So the question I've been asked is, what is the future of film? See, I'm not a filmmaker. I'm a storyteller. Can everybody sit down and be quiet? I've come a long way to talk to you. Okay. Can you keep quiet, please? Right? Thank you. So I don't think that we are... need to confine ourselves to be filmmakers. We're storytellers. Most of the questions that I keep getting asked about filmmaking is, which way is film going? And unfortunately, film is now, till now, being only seen as a theatrical experience. And that's our biggest problem, has been all the time. India only has about 9,000 or 10,000 screens, and they're declining. In comparison, let's say China, where they're adding 15 screens every day. So we have to think away from theatrical releases. We have to find platforms beyond theatrical releases. If we are to encourage new talent, if we are to go into forms of new filmmaking, if we are to experiment, we have to go beyond theater. And now suddenly, the opportunities are huge. We have cell phones, right? We have 800 million cell phones in India. Is that a market that filmmakers should be exploiting? As against 6,000 screens. We have Amazon here, we have Netflix here, we have a number of platforms. So when I ask, you know, when I get, people ask me and they're filming me on their cell phones and they say, sir, how do we become a filmmaker? And I said, you're filming me, right? Yes, sir. Do you have an editing facility in your phone or your computer? Yes, sir. I said, then what's the problem? You're a filmmaker. You're shooting? You're editing, you can go home, you can upload it to YouTube, right? So you're a writer, filmmaker, editor, and your own distributor. So what's the problem? What are you looking for? When I started my first film for Masoom, I had no choice but to take a 35mm camera or a 16mm camera, get the money, buy the raw stock, and the only way that I could release my film was theatrically. Now you can release your film in any way possible. So I really going to invite some questions from you. Remember that art has always followed the technology of distribution. Right from the time that the cavemen wanted to tell stories. So we have these 5,000-year-old caves or 10,000-year-old caves where you realize that the cavemen have taken stone and engraved paintings one after the other like a comic book to tell their stories. When my daughter was a kid, her technology was crayons. As filmmakers, our technology has been cameras and film and now digital. But as technology goes on increasing, then our ways and means of telling stories goes on increasing. And we should not confine ourselves to say, I want to make films theatrically. We should be able to open ourselves to whatever digital platforms, whatever platforms are being offered right now. And the number of platforms and the number of possibilities is going on every day. Right now, I'm making a VR experience, right? Virtual reality. I'm making a, is that a film? Is that a story? Or is that virtual reality experience? It's storytelling. I am now adapting to storytelling in the new form that's going to come up, which is now taking the world by storm, which is virtual reality. People, we keep saying our business is increasing. If you look at the number of people that are going to theaters, that's decreasing. We talk about multiplexes. 95% of India cannot afford to go to multiplexes. We used to say film in India is a mass medium. How can it be mass medium if 95% of the films of the audience can't go to see a cinema because it's too expensive? I came You know, I came from America. One day I landed, my driver and my peon came to pick me up, and I was just talking, and my peon said, "Sir, aap Sairat zarur dekhiye. Bahut khoobsurat film hai, bahut achhi film hai." Maine kaha, "Haan, main dekhunga, lekin tum to theater jaate nahi ho. To tumne kahan dekh li?" Kaha, "Sir, Sairat par dekhi." Said, "Sairat, Sairat, what are you talking about?" Then my driver said, "Sir, Sairat bahut achhi film hai, aap zarur dekhiye." Maine kaha, "Aap theater gaye?" Said, "Nahi sir, Sairat par dekhi." Sairat kya hai? I realized they were saying Share It. There's an app called Share It. They've all seen it. And yet the film's done over 100 crores. And yet 90% of them have not gone to the theater to see it. They've seen it on their phones. Those of you that can afford big houses and security have chowkidars, right? Go downstairs in the middle of the night. Here's what your chowkidar is doing. They're watching films on their phones. Oh, chor nikal jayega, wo film dekhta rahega, right? So there is any number. We have to, as storytellers, we have to adapt to every platform, every means that are given to us. And those means are increasing all the time, and it's given you, which of, how many of you want to make a film? Raise your hands. Don't be shy. Come on, don't be shy. How many of you have got the funding to make a film? One, two, out of the 100 or so that said. Oh, you got two hands up. And those that you don't have funding, how much money do you need? There is a whole company that we've launched called Zero Budget Filmmaking. It doesn't take money. If you want to be a famous theatrical filmmaker, then you want to be famous. Which comes first? You want to make a film? You want to express your stories, or you want to be famous? I'm hoping that it's you want to make a film, you want to express yourself. There's nothing stopping you. What is stopping you? Do you have a story? You have a cell phone? You have an editing facility? You have YouTube, you can launch it. What's stopping you? I don't get it. I don't get the problem. What is the problem? I wish I had that when I first started making films. I would have made 2,000 films instead of 5 or 6. Ab main phas gaya. But you have to. It is a vast thing. You just have to understand that the technology of distribution is changing. You have to adapt yourself to it. But more than adapt yourself to it, you have to see it with, not as a challenge. People talk about piracy. More people are watching the film than ever before, and yet theater revenues are going up. Actually, what's happening is that ticket prices are going up, people are going down. But more people are watching films than ever before. They're watching them on new platforms. And we shouldn't be arrogant enough to say, "Niji, main to sirf theater pe jaunga." We should go out and tell our stories, because fundamentally, filmmaking is about visual storytelling. And it doesn't matter how you do it. Okay, I'm going to say the same thing. There is a lot more ideas and things, but if you have any questions, please ask them very quickly, because everybody's waiting for Kangana to come up, all right? So any questions? Otherwise, I have to leave, because I can see everybody looking there, right? You're too shy. That's fine. Yes, of course. I've just done a big TV series on William Shakespeare. It's 10 hours. I'm going out now to make a film on Bruce Lee, on his life. So I'm shooting in China right now. You'll probably see that, but you know, I want to come back, and my fascinating pet project still remains is Pani. And why would I not? How many of you want to see Pani? See? Why is it not being made? Can anybody tell me that? Arey yar, mujhe malum hota to main banana deta abhi tak. Pani ka na? Haan, jab Pani khatam ho jayega to meri film Pani aa jayegi. No, it's fabulous, and in a way, Rajmouli set the trend. I really, really admire Rajmouli, because what he did was, he showed us that when you have a very big story to tell, do it in two parts. And that's what I'm going to do with Pani now. I'm going to do it in two parts, because it's a story I've written over many, many years. It's a really important story. So who says ki film, all of it should be in one part? It could be in two parts. And it's cheaper, right? Okay, so wish me luck, And if there are no more questions, I think I've done my 15 minutes. Yes, ma'am, go ahead.
जो आपने कहा स्टोरी टेलिंग इज ऑल अबाउट, तो ये सारा तो सिर्फ एक मीडियम है, तो कॉन्सेप्ट में आपको क्या लगता है कि हम सोसाइटी को अहेड ऑफ टाइम लेके जा रहे हैं या उनको कुछ दे रहे हैं जिससे वो लुक अपॉन कर सके कि हाँ दिस माइट बी अ क्राइटेरिया?
देखिए, मैंने आर्ट सोसाइटी को फॉलो करता है और आर्ट सोसाइटी को चैलेंज करता है. साइंस शायद सोसाइटी को आगे बढ़ा देता है और टेक्नोलॉजी आगे बढ़ा देता है, लेकिन कभी कभी ऐसी फिल्म है कि प्रॉब्लम ये है. प्रॉब्लम जैसे मैंने बैंडेड क्वीन बनाई, किसने देखी? क्या सब ने देखी? ठीक है, बैंडेड क्वीन में प्रॉब्लम स्टेट की कि ये ऐसा है और ऐसा आगे इसको ठीक करना है, इस समस्या को देखना है, ठीक तरह से देखना है, इसको आगे बढ़ाना है और इसकी सोल्यूशंस निकालनी है. बैंडेड क्वीन में आप देखें सर, आपके सर सोल्यूशन क्या है? सोल्यूशन तो एक बहुत बड़ी सोसाइटी की सोल्यूशन होती है.
सॉरी टू इंटरप्ट, लेकिन आपने मिस्टर इंडिया भी बनाई, जो अब शायद कुछ समय में ये पॉसिबल हो पाएगा कि लोग इनविजिबल हो जाए.
वो तो हो चुका है अभी. आप साइंस अगर पढ़ते रहें तो इस साइंस में ऐसा है कि वो लाइट ऐसे, दे विल पुट लाइट ऐसे करेंगे तो यहाँ से इर्द गिर्द जाकर वहाँ आ जाएगी और आपको ऐसे लगेगा कि मैं हूँ ही नहीं. वो तो पॉसिबल हो गया है. वो जो हमने कहा था, वो मिस्टर अशोक कुमार का डायलॉग था, वो सच हो गया. अब तो बहुत साइंटिफिक रिसर्च के बाद मिस्टर इंडिया आप इनविजिबल हो सकते हैं. आप जब मुझसे बात करेंगे अगली बार तो मैं देख नहीं पाऊंगा आपको, मैं कहूँगी ये आवाज़ कहाँ से आ रही है ना, तो वो ये भी हो जाएगा. यार ऐसा होता है कि एक चीज़ जब आप बना चुके हैं ना और इतनी बड़ी हिट हो गई है तो उसको आप रिपीट करके ना उसको बिगाड़ देंगे. तो कोई और अच्छा डायरेक्टर हो और लोग हों उनको बनानी चाहिए, क्योंकि मैं तो कर चुका हूँ ना. पार्ट टू अब क्या बनाऊंगा यार, है मेरे पास लोग आते रहते हैं. मैं आपको एक बात बताऊं और फिर निकल जाऊंगा यहाँ से. लोग मेरे पास आते हैं, कहते हैं सर मिस्टर इंडिया आप बना दीजिए, देखिए 3 हफ्ते में 250 करोड़ कर लेगी या 300 करोड़ कर लेगी, पूरा पैसा आपको हम 300 करोड़ देते हैं और 300 करोड़ आप 3 हफ्ते में कमा लेंगे. फिर मैं कहता हूँ यार देखो, मैंने एक फिल्म बनाई थी जो 30 साल चली. अब आप मुझे कह रहे हैं कि आप ऐसी पिक्चर बनाओ जो 3 हफ्ते चले, मुझे समझ में नहीं आ रही है ना.
थैंक यू वेरी मच, थैंक्स फॉर कॉलिंग मी. आई नो इट वाज लास्ट मिनट एंड आई एम टेकिंग टाइम फ्रॉम द ब्यूटीफुल यंग वंडरफुल ग्रेट एक्ट्रेस हु इज ऑलवेज रिफ्यूज टू वर्क विद मी, शी इज राइट हियर. कंगना, इट्स योर स्टेज. थैंक यू.
That was certainly a shot in the arm for most filmmakers, wannabe filmmakers, cinematographers sitting here. And thank you so much, Shekhar Kapoor, for that keynote address. Before we carry on, ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to call on stage Mr. Basant Rathore to come and say a few words. Please put your hands together.
On behalf of the Jagan Group, I'd like to invite all of you formally for the first ever Jagan Cinema Summit. And I think the entire debate has been opened up really by Mr. Kapoor. I think some of you who've been following cinema would obviously be aware of the thing that happened at Cannes very recently this year, where they admitted 2 Netflix films as part of their official competitive list. And there was a huge critical backlash around it. And when these films were screened, they were met with boos. And when these films ended, there was a standing ovation. So basically what's really happened is that Cannes later on went on to say that from next year onward, that is 2018 onwards, a film will have to have a theatrical release in France for it to do a preview or a premiere at Cannes. So the entire debate of what really constitutes a film is once again out in the open. Is it a theatrical release, or is it a movie that's streaming down to your phone and so on and so forth? So this entire debate has been on for such a long time. Mediums have been legitimized and delegitimized over a period of time. And I think there's a whole lot of issues that the industry really needs to tackle with. And what we've really done is the Jagan Cinema Summit is essentially a platform where thought leaders from the industry are going to get together and discuss the future of cinema and take it to its right direction. And that's it. Thank you so much once again for all of you.
Thank you, Basant. Ladies and gentlemen, first things first. We know we are why we are all here. We are here today as an industry of people who love cinema, cinema makers. And as an industry, I think we all know that we're one of the largest in the world. Our films are accepted, watched with love, awe, wonder, not just in India, but also across the globe. And it's really quite overwhelming, even for the toughest cinema cynic. With a staggering output of more than 2,000 films a year, landmark directors, mega stars, memorable songs, dance extravaganzas, we are, hands down, the world's most prolific film industry. Enough and more has been written about us, how we've withstood the test of time, how we have a unique identity that is unmatched, and how, courtesy all the technological evolution, it continues to do that. Well, that one thing that it has successfully done ever since the evolution of cinema in our country, which is to thrill, to provoke, and to entertain audiences. But interestingly, you know, thrill is finds a new definition in every era, and it is a new kind of thrill that greets a new set of audience. So today's audience is far more exposed, it's far more evolved, more experimental, more invested in what they want to see. So thrill really takes on a different avatar, and it's mostly everything that resonates with the people and their changing values as well. If you really look at, I know this is sounding like a bit of a college lecture, but this is really needs to be said. The most recent, if you really look at the most critically acclaimed pieces of work today, they deal with breaking the diktats of mainstream cinema, not following it. They are simple, but bold, relatable, yet inspiring. They make us uncomfortable, they make us think. And quite honestly, barriers to filmmaking has never, ever been lower than they are today. We've got new voices of a changing India. We've got new directors with global voices. We've got young, hungry, maverick actors getting out of their comfort zones, willing to take on roles that give life to a compelling vision. We can see this as being on the edge of a precipice, or we can see this as a new opportunity, but our industry has never been a more exciting place to be. On that note, I would like to invite on stage an award-winning film critic, author, journalist, and a very dear friend. Please put your hands together for the wonderful Mayank Shekhar. Woohoo, come on, we can be louder than that. How dapper do you look in that suit, huh? And joining Mayank today, you know, will be a supremely talented and fierce actor who's known for her very honest and very blatant portrayals, opinions. She's managed to shake up a lot of mindsets, dared to question everything that was deemed out of reach for women actors. She's made a strong place for herself in the industry with her various powerhouse mired roles, and she is a fashionista, is also the recipient of 3 National Film Awards, pretty much the reigning queen of Bollywood. I'm a big fan, ladies and gentlemen. Please put your hands together for the lovely Kangana Ranaut.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the first session of the first Jagran Cinema Summit. This is also Mumbai's first cinema summit, by the way. And I have good reasons to believe this is actually the world's first cinema summit. The reason I say that is because we have the Twitter handle Cinema Summit. Nobody else has it. So either we got lucky, or there's actually no other cinema summit of that nature. The whole point of doing this, of course, and of course, there have been various conventions and film forums in the past that deal with media as an industry. But the point of the Cinema Summit per se is to provide a platform and a perspective, or to get the perspective of producers of entertainment. So far as the consumers of entertainment is concerned, we already have the Jagran Film Festival that travels to 16 Indian cities, that comes to Mumbai on September 18th. Guys, please register for the festival. It's on from 18th to 24th. Coming back to the summit though, I could not think of anyone better than the lady in the house to kickstart this for a couple of reasons. One is that you're, of course, the present of heroine. And of course, we look at the future of the heroine. But as an actor, you've actually looked very closely at also the history of the heroine. Your last role, Kangana, as Julia, was a Bollywood star of the 1940s. While researching for that character, what did you come across in terms of finding the position or the role of the women in the film industry, in the Mumbai film industry in the 1940s? What was it like then?
First of all, thank you, Mayank, sir. Thank you for inviting me for this. It's extremely prestigious platform to be at and to have Shekhar sir here. He's a very dear friend and he's my favorite filmmaker. It's been a wonderful day so far. Coming to Julia, to my surprise, you know, when I was doing my research on that character, I was taken aback that there was a lot more acceptance for a feisty character, like a woman fighter, like a woman stunt, and she was one big woman, used to wear shorts and carry two men on her shoulders and ride a horse, and a stunt woman in those days, and people were okay with that. People were okay with, that sort of acceptance of a woman's, like a fierce persona. And I think we just, instead of going upwards from that, our cinema and the perception of women somewhere started to descend. And where we are today, action is pretty much just to, delve into the beautiful physical appearance of a woman or to make them look sexy. But that was serious action, like Julia, the character was inspired from. Was from many stunt women in those days who did their own action, and they were not like, it wasn't a comedy that they were beating up men in their like serious action films. They were the saviors, they were the superheroes, they were the women who were in love stories were saving the men they were in love with, and they were all serious films, they were not comedies. So I think somewhere, that growth didn't go into the right direction. Of course, Julia's story, her personal life was a reflection of how women has been, in the past, and her need to have a surname and her need to have a social security, in terms of acceptance of a man and a lover. I think that's quite prevalent even today. That's what I learned from that character.
But, Kangana, the fact is also that if you go back in history, the first heroine in Hindi cinema, or Indian cinema as it were, was actually a man. Anna Salunke was a man who played the first heroine in Raja Harishchandra, the first Indian film. Now, back then, and you need to tell me a little bit about the 40s because you have researched that part of the history, people from respectable families, so to say, did not send their daughters to work in cinema. Do you think that's changed a lot?
Of course. I think in those days, women were very protected. I mean, according to the feudal mindset, protected means confine them to the four wall of the house or the veil or other sort of the physical layers of maybe clothing or culture, but not the real protection that I'm talking about. I think women were confined to a very strict, especially the ones who came from so-called, good families and good backgrounds. So that's true that there was a certain section and it was not considered, even in my family, when I was pursuing acting, it was not looked at something which is respectable or what I depicted, in the film in terms of, I remember my mom telling me that, I asked her, I said, how did you like Gangster? And she's like, I loved it, but your dad is not very happy. And I'm like, why is he not happy about it? He's like, maybe there's a lot of, so depiction of passion or backless. So it was very upsetting for my family. But I remember Shekhar sir coming in on Metro set. He told me how beautiful he expressed his almost awe for the shot that I remember where my gun was on my head, and Shekhar sir said that the most beautiful thing that I've seen, that the emotion from fear to acceptance, is so beautiful, Kangana, and at this young age you depicted that is so beautiful. And I'm like, you know, I mean, my family would never feel that way for me ever, you know, because all they see is that there was a backless shot in the film. So yeah, I think it's difficult to rise above that mentality. It's difficult being a woman or an actress to, you know, to rise above the sexuality. I mean, as much we would want to be, you know, an ideal world and all of that, but it sure does, you know, delve in our minds.
Right. But if there was a young girl in a village in Himachal right now, in 2017, how difficult or how easy would it be for that person to come to Bombay and make it movies? Would you be that inspiration for that person? Would you personally advise that person to do it? Or would they be actually scared of a lot of the stories that you've actually revealed in the past few weeks in terms of what you went through?
Yeah, see, this is a conscious effort that I make to tell the brighter side and the darker side, you know, because I don't want to give a very hunky-dory picture of my life. It's very easy to portray a fairy tale and to make yourself the center of the world and to portray yourself larger than life and almost the God's favorite child. It's very heartbreaking to actually put the real picture out there and be like, you know, I don't know if I've been really lucky or really unfortunate, but that is your depiction or your perspective, but this is how it is. And if tomorrow you want to walk the same path, know that you might or might not make it. So it's good to have that approach, because I really don't have any method to my journey. I don't know if, you know, like it's hard to tell how exactly I made it. You know, people sometimes ask me that, where did you get so much strength from? It's not just strength. Sometimes, you know, there were incidences that I just, I don't know how I just made it through those, you know, series of events. So I can just, in my place, I can just be very honest and mentally prepare everyone that this is how it is. It's as magical as, you know, it can get. But at the same time, I think magic comes with its little bit price tag, which is sometimes you might not want to pay. So yeah, this is how it is for me, at least.
And you were the extreme outsider, as it were. And since we're looking at also the past of the heroine while discussing the future, and you've spoken a lot in the past also about star system and the dynasty that follows. But the fact is, when you talk about dynasties, I'm not using the N word, I haven't yet. When you talk about dynasties, the lineage has traditionally in Bollywood been between the father and the son. So the father is a producer, the son could be a star. The father is a star, the son could be a producer. For decades on end, and up until a couple of decades ago, or perhaps a decade ago, people from film families did not send their daughters or their wives to work in the movies. One, what does that mean in terms of why do you think that was the case? Because all the heroines mostly have been outsiders in that sense. Why do you think they chose not to do it?
It's something very hurtful, and it's something very, if I say in a very upfront way, it might just make very severe headlines. So I try and be
go for it, Kangana.
I try and be as, I'd say, as soft I can be. But I think it comes from the deep-rooted patriarchal mindset where, you know, the way one treats a woman and the way one sees a woman, you know, it reflects in his relationship with his daughter or his wife. And, you know, like in the world of glamour and the world of opportunities, we all know that, you know, being in this, you know, amazing, it's almost like a fantasy land. It's almost like a, you know, to be in a film business or to be in any show business for that matter is, you know, it's full of magic. It's full of epiphanies. It's full of creativity, neurotic artists and opportunities. And above everything, it's full of that magic which overnight changes everything and makes life, you know, turns ordinary into extraordinary, extraordinary into fantastic, and fantastic into tragic. You know, it has that extraordinary power to it. So yes, it's a land of opportunities, and you meet people, and you have these endless opportunities. But when we see a man do that, we don't find anything wrong in this. You know, to have multiple sort of, you know, opportunities, to be a millionaire, have multiple mating partners, and you know, so just go about living your life like a maverick. But when it comes to a woman, you know, there's a there's a strong sense of guilt that comes along with it. You know, for a man, it's unbelievable, you know, that how a man perceive his own, you know, sexual life and the woman that, maybe he's dating or are, you know, I think it's always assumed that sex for a woman is actually something a kind of tragic for them, right? So I think, is there a brawl outside? Okay, yeah, sorry, I got distracted. So I think I know a lot of people who are being very protective of their women, and it's all about keeping them away from a lot of men or opportunities or glamour, because why, they're going to get swayed with it, they're going to have affairs and men are going to treat them badly, basically men are going to have sex with them. So having sex for a man is something which is about having fun and living a good life, but for a woman it's something which is, you know, like doing some sort of like a bad thing to them. So that is how a man perceives, you know, the life in glamour world. They openly say this, you know, that when it's an affair of their son, you will hear so many men brag about it, you know, that my son is this,
the Casanova.
Casanova, and he's, what will he do in his youth, you know, and if not have these multiple affairs, they openly talk about it. But when it comes to their girls, you know, there are restrictions, and they flaunt that. How dare my girl is going to date anyone? How dare my girl is getting into films, and people are going to see her wear mini skirts? And these are these petty reasons. I mean, I wouldn't want to, I wish it was anything else, but these are the petty reasons that my girl is going to wear bikini, but I don't mind having 15 bikini-clad women around me or my son. It's as petty as it is. I mean, it sounds stupid, but you can have so many, you would know, there's so many examples of that. And they're quite open about it, and they feel it's very manly to have these kind of values, not really values, but these sort of feudal ideologies, and to flaunt it like that. And it's making our society even more regressive, even more feudal and chauvinistic, you know, these sort of, and it does stem out of it that, you know, like a great family of, you know, like this film business, son will make, and this happens in many small industries as well. It's a common fact that, I don't want to name superstars because I'm not sure, but someone's daughter decided to be an actress and fans committed suicide. Fans committed suicide. That, and the son is, of course, is the reigning superstar. But the daughter decided.
Fans committing suicide would have to be south of India, no?
Yes, south of India. Sure. Yeah. So they committed suicide. That the daughter of the house will wear a mini skirt. How would that happen? And how is that even possible? So this is the psyche of our culture, and this is how the masses. This is what a woman is, just an object. And it's very unfortunate that, you know, there is, that's all, you know.
But you see that changing too, because from like the early 2000s onwards, you do see a lot of women from film families actually entering films. And so do you think the film industry has changed? Do you think the psyche of those families have changed? What do you think has led to that change?
Well, I think most probably the society in itself, you know. I think initially to begin with, our cinema was extremely premature, and the way exactly, you know, the way the industry was, it wasn't, this sort of a flourishing business proposition. But how it became, I think, more progressive, more people decided to, sort of get into it, and that's how times the films have come a long way, right? They have come from being very primitive to fairly, I'd say we are not yet there, and I'm not sure if we will ever be, but we have come.
Somewhere. You mean less shady people in the films?
Sorry?
Less shady people in the movies also?
Well, see, Also, film business has many levels to it, right? Like, there are all kind of cinemas. Right. There are so I can't really guarantee that.
Sure.
But it's definitely it's. I don't think, like, you know, it's definitely a business where a lot of people, educated people, and yeah, and the ones who are you know, who are sort of who understand the business for what it is.
Right.
Yeah.
Because the other diktat when it comes to the heroine in Bollywood has always been that marriage was always seen as a retirement plan. The reason you get married is because you're done with show business, because that's a, you know, one-way street. And of course, a lot of them actually made comebacks much later, but a lot of water had flown under the bridge. Do you see that? Because in fact, you yourself, at some level, have been a huge beneficiary of that. Your first film, Gangster, Chitrangada Singh was supposed to play that part right until the end. Then she gets married. Then the husband says, you will not work in movies. So there's a slot ready, you have a week to go, you get a passport, and you get your debut film. You've actually benefited from that. Do you think that tag of being a married person and therefore losing out on so-called fan base, because this was also true for male stars back in the day, Govinda hid the fact that he was married, I think even Aman hid the fact that he was married when he entered films. Do you think that's finally going though, and it's about the artist?
Of course. Of course, I think a lot has changed, you know, from those days where people really cared about someone's marital status or, you know, someone's age. A lot has changed for that matter. So, yeah, I don't think it's of any consequence anymore. But there is definitely a section of the society who is, who do, you know, like an older woman is always, you know, referred to as this, you know, like there's always mocking women for being older, and when you're young, you're, you know, mocked for being young.
Sure.
so that's there, but it has definitely changed, and we can see the change around us. But I think just for last few years, four, 5 years, and before that, I think many women were just forced to leave the industry, even though they looked the same.
Right.
Even though there was no, like, change in their appearance, but they were just not accepted anymore.
Right, because, you know, earlier in the year, I think it was around January, you announced that you're going to get married this year. It's what, 2 months or 3 months left?
Yeah.
Like, are you getting invitation cards soon?
Yeah, most definitely.
Really? You're actually getting married in the next 3 months?
Well, we'll talk about that at some
other
time.
We'll talk about your career, Kangana. We started with Gangster, of course. But I have an interesting story with regards to you. And this is, I think, 2012. You invited me to your birthday party. I don't know if you remember. This was in...
Of course, I remember.
In Olive,
yeah.
In Bandra. Very sober affair, very nicely done, friends, some media people. And it was what you would call a small birthday party, as birthday parties should be. Then 2014, Queen happens. Thank you for not inviting me to your birthday party that year. But I saw the pictures, and absolutely the entire Bollywood A-list was lined up outside your house, Amitabh Bachchan onwards. That's how things turn in show business. What does something like that teach you about the world in general and showbiz in particular?
Like I said, Mayank, you know, there is a fantastic quality to this world, you know, when especially the field of art. You know, it can make you, these extreme circumstances sometimes can make you a bit, you know, a bit, and it's a bit unsettling,
sure,
you know, to go from one extreme to the other. And once if you've sort of tasted that sort of shift, it's very hard to come back to the ordinariness of life, you know.
Right.
So that's true. And I don't know if I am a recipient of that sort of, you know, magic and that sort of, you know, shift, or I am a victim of it. Because you never know, because sometimes it just feels that it hits you so suddenly that you're just never ready for it.
Right.
You know, so whether it's long, never-ending struggle, and then the extreme success of being in a film, which has, in a way, changed a lot of things in the industry, not just in your life. So yeah, these kind of extreme circumstances can be very hard to deal with.
Can fame be a drug, though? Something that you would crave if you didn't find it?
Well, to my surprise, what happens is when success, you know, when you success often, you know, comes when you stop to hope for it.
Really?
You don't, yeah. When you're not anticipating it, and it hits you like a like something has, you know, hit you in your head, and very hard to come to terms with it.
Right.
And the initial reaction is of rejection. You know, you don't want to accept it because you don't know what to do with it. And the, by the time you get used to it, you know, it's gone.
No, what is fascinating about you, Kangana, is that you finish a film like Queen, and the first thing you do is apply for a student's visa. And then you move to the US to study screenwriting in New York. Why would you do that? I have two, I mean, sub possible multiple choice answers for you. One, is it the fact that your career will be much longer regardless of what roles you get if you're a filmmaker, because you can continue to express yourself and not wait for someone to offer you a role? Or second, you actually wanted to collaborate in the process itself while being an actor and to actually learn it, learn the craft?
I think both are the same things,
sure,
aren't they? Like, yeah, I wanted to be more collaborative because, you know, being in Queen and to have that kind of freedom. Also, Queen came from a very pure space because Vikas sir had not directed any film before, and Phantom's first film was, you know, like new production house. So they did, like I said, you know, they were not thirsty or hungry for success. They were making a film like,
for the right reason.
Yeah, like it doesn't matter whatever the fate of the film is. So the kind of lightness and the kind of environment I collaborated in, I got addicted to it, you
right.
know, and I felt, hi Vic. So, and I felt, you know, like I should know the technicalities of this world because I felt a bit amateur, you know,
sure.
To be among professionals and wanted to express myself, and I had no accurate words or I could not place my thoughts properly because I didn't have any formal education. So that's why I did that.
And did you overlearn at some point where people are like, hey, like, don't teach me, I know my filmmaking? Is that happening to you?
Well, that, yeah, of course. I mean, I think it's a, there are no rules,
sure.
You know, when you go to a set, it can become, everyone's very vulnerable. Why? Because we know that no matter how good a script is, it can always be a trashy film. And no matter how trashy a film is, it can always be a blockbuster. And no matter how big a blockbuster it is, it might just be the most embarrassing film of the year. So, you know, there is a lot of uncertainty that comes with
right.
this business. And for anyone to say that, hey, I know everything, is an idiot around, you know. And all you can do is just be tentative. And in that tentative environment, to find your ground and to just know whether into which direction to go, it takes a lot of faith in each other.
Right.
And that's exactly what people lack when they're nervous. You know, and it can, this business is such, it can be very demanding. And when you're nervous, you don't have faith in yourself. Forget having faith in anyone else. So I think it is very hard. It's very hard to collaborate. And like I said, there's no formula to it. If we were making cars or packing water or doing anything else, like I would say that, oh, hey, this is how it's done and this is how it's been happening for past these many years. And this is the formula if you're making a drug, you know. But to this, there's no formula. So, and also everyone is waiting for that something to happen, you know, that some sort of magic, some sort of blessing to fall from somewhere. And you don't know from who it'll come from, you know. So there is always that search of that, that sort of, you know, epiphany. Sometimes it is bestowed upon you and sometimes it's not, and you don't know why it happens and why it doesn't. So it's a weird world to be in.
But can being the sole female protagonist be a formula? Is it true that you've turned down various roles because you're not the sole female protagonist, or sole protagonist, as it were, in the film? Is it true about Sultan, for instance, that you said no because that was a Salman Khan film? Is it true, and this has been reported, you'll have to confirm this or deny, of course, that you said no to Thugs of Hindustan,
yes,
that stars Aamir Khan and Amitabh Bachchan? Now, a film like, say, for instance, Sultan, that's going to travel a wide distance. You will be viewed by a lot more people. Why would you not take that as an opportunity?
Well, See, what happens is, knowing today's time, I am going to go for something which is going to stimulate my mind, you know, because otherwise I am going to be just sleepwalking through the film. Mm. You know, like I said, like Sultan at that point of time, though it was a great character for a girl to play, but I did not see, you know, anything for me in that. Mm. And coming from like a double role space and doing so much more in my earlier films, I felt, why would I demote myself to you know, something which is not offering me so much? So that's why I didn't do it. And Thugs, no, I was never offered. I don't even know what the script is.
Like, speaking of your double role, Kangana, thank you very much for Tanu Veds Manu too. We were going through exactly how you approach a character, and in one of the interviews you've said, so what you do is you look at the person in terms of the character that you play, and you give that person one characteristic trait, one word, and that's how you move forward. And so Datto was supposed to be, from Tanu Veds Manu, Two was supposed to be swag.
Yeah.
Julia was supposed to be needy.
Needy, yeah.
You're a character yourself. If you were to describe yourself in one word, what would that be?
Oh my God. One word. Well, brave.
Thanks. Well done. I mean, you would have to be brave, Kangana. The past few weeks, you've been on a serious Rani of Jhansi mode from all the interviews that we've watched of yours. And that's your next film. That's the movie that you're currently working on. How's that coming along? You got hurt on the sets as well?
Oh yeah, I had a big cut on my head. I almost lost my eyes. Thank you, Nihar Pandey, who missed his cue and hit me on the wrong cue. And he keeps telling me, do you think I did it on purpose? I said, I don't know. I really don't. And he's like, you're mean. So these things happen. But yeah, I got saved, and I'm very happy about that. And also, that character, yes, I think somewhere a character that you play, it does affect you and your life and the way you think, you know, the what a character can expose, you know, you, like, I remember when I played a cancer patient, I was suddenly exposed to my own mortality as a human being. Yeah.
Yes.
As a human being, and since then I've never been the same. So a character can be extremely cathartic for you as well. So with Jhansi Ki Rani, and how fearlessly a 28-year-old just, you know, set herself on fire for a cause, there is something so amazing about it that is infectious, you know, that that it does make you feel so small, you know, that what you worry about, you know, like these small comfort, these small luxuries, these small achievements that you have to your credit, you're so possessive of it, and people have let go of so much for the bigger picture. It does affect you as an individual, and you do feel that, that, you know, like, I'm a different person now. So, I do feel like this character has shown me a side of me which I need it to at this point of time.
So you are on the Rani of Jhansi mode.
Of course.
I wasn't too wrong. But it's not the first time you've been this brave, Kangana. I was actually watching an interview of yours where you casually mentioned that you were shooting for a film, Revolver Rani, and that you were held at gunpoint. And then there was some other question asked, and I'm sorry, but it's not very common for people to be going on shoots and being actually held at gunpoint. What was that story?
Oh yeah, so we were in Chambal, which is, you know, famous for rebels. And so we were shooting there for 3-4 days, and there were some drunk people who came when they had guns and all. Say, they put gun on Kabir's head,
okay,
my director's head, that, get your actress out, we want to click a picture with her. So, and I was in the car behind him. So there was this some sort of, you know, checking point or something. So, and I'm getting really restless. I'm like, why these cars have stopped suddenly and we are behind them, we can't go ahead. And we had to go to Gwalior. We used to drive every night to Gwalior. So I said, you know, Kabir has stopped. I thought maybe some friends of his, because he's from Gwalior, and he had some. So they're not moving only. And Kabir came out and he started to fight. So he called his co friends, and I'm like, what is going on? Let me go at least. So Kabir came. He's like, they want you only. You stay quiet for 10, 15 minutes because they only want you. I'm like, okay, I can wait as long you want. So yeah, there was a story, but he was very brave. He was very brave. He was like, you click a picture with me. Kangna is not coming out. So then these people got, I think somehow we got saved, and they didn't shoot anyone, and then we left, and this now, yeah, remains as a funny story. It could have been a very tragic one as well. So yeah, that's how it is.
When you get to your public persona, Kangna, and there are lots of, for a lot of people, men and women included, you are seen as a feminist icon. And for a lot of people, men and women included, you're seen as a complete man-hater, okay? My final question to you, as we end the session, is, do you give a shit?
Well, I think I definitely don't. Okay. You know, but you know, I'm not a man-hater.
Sure.
Yeah, I'm not a man-hater. In fact, I'm not sure when I became a feminist, you know. I'm just, for me, like, I personally believe, I find it, the whole inequality and whole perception about one being inferior to the other is so bizarre for me to come to terms with, you know. I just can't understand it. And the law of universal equality somewhere, just, you know, just makes me look like a, because I believe in that, makes me look like a feminist. But, you know, I mean, I honestly just feel that feminism is something which is very, it's a sorry state to be in for any society, you know, because you're lacking something. You're lacking something, and feminism is acting as a medicine to that sort of illness or disease. We should not have it. We should not have it at all. We should not have feminists. We should not have these, you know, sort of techniques, or we should be a healthy society. We should believe in equality, and that's how it is. And there are, I mean, there is nothing that can prove it otherwise. So it's bizarre that people actually believe that, you know, one section of society is lesser than the other. Yeah, so I definitely don't hate men. You are a friend for so long, and I have, you know, like a, I have amazing set of friends, and you'll be shocked, most of them are men.
Super. Well done, Kangna. Do we have time for questions? Yes? Couple of questions, please. At the back.
So, thank you. Kangna, you have been called as one of the most fashionable icon the actresses Bollywood has got, and still you are so much vocal to your thoughts, to your views, be it any topic, be it nepotism, be it the casteism, and be it the religious fanatism. So what makes you go up with such kind of views, and is that the way that you are being, like, I mean, just selecting the movies which just throws a views about you that you are a feminist person, and that just depicts that you are a strong woman?
So movies are completely different. Like a person's, an individual's choices or voice should not be affected by their profession. Like, movies should not determine, or my profession should not determine my voice as an individual. I am... like, first and foremost, the citizen of this country. I'm a woman. I'm an individual. So my films should not determine, like, my career should not determine if I'm an engineer or doctor or an actor. It should not determine what I feel about this current, you know, state of events, or myself, my past, my present. It should be a free voice, free as in free of all the baggage. That's what I try. And my films, whatever I do, you know, my first interview that went completely viral, and still the most watched interview, is pre-Queen with in 2013 with Anupama Chopra. So I always had, and I made sure that no matter if I'm a successful actor or not so successful, but I want to be a successful human being. I want to be a successful person. And that's, my profession is not going to determine that.
And just one more, Kangna, there's a huge shift. The huge number of trawlers these days who just go on trawling and just go to any limits. So do you just, does this affect your work and affect your choice of films?
Trolls.
Yeah, trawlers who just grew up in the social media.
No, I'm not on social media, and I definitely don't go through all the trolling that I might be getting.
Do you secretly go, though, to check what people are saying online?
No.
Come on.
No, it's very upsetting. It's very upsetting. Sometimes I get these feedback from my digital team. It's, some of them is so upsetting, it can scar you for life. You don't want to go through that. Thank you.
Film का film पूरी जिसमें film के जो dialogues हैं वो बहुत अच्छे हैं. मैं चाहूँगा कि आपका पसंदीदा dialogue कौन सा है और क्यों?
मेरा पसंदीदा dialogue वैसे तो काफी हैं, लेकिन मुझे सबसे अच्छा वो लगता है कि जब प्रफुल्ल उसे कहती है कि किसी को जानना चाहिए, पहचाना चाहिए, तो कहता है इंसान को कभी अच्छे से जाना नहीं जा, समझा नहीं जा सकता, बदलते रहना ही इंसान की फितरत है. रिश्ते रिश्तों को समझा नहीं, सिर्फ निभाया जाता है. सो आई हैव रिटन दोज लाइंस एंड आई रियली लाइक इट.
कंगना आपके सामने 18 सितंबर को शबाना आजमी जी का जन्मदिन है, तो कुछ विश करना चाहेंगी उनको?
अरे
बहुत बहुत शुभकामनाएं उनको जन्मदिन की.
आप कभी उनको फॉलो?
या गाइस,
क्या चीज? ये तो यहाँ पे ओपन ट्रोलिंग हो गई.
कंगना, आपने कभी उनको फॉलो किया है?
किसको?
शबाना आजमी जी.
मैं हुई नहीं ट्विटर पे.
सर ने ऐसे पर्सनल लाइफ में एक्टिंग
के लेट्स आस्क जेन्युइन क्वेश्चंस इज टर्निंग इनटू अ प्रेस कॉन्फ्रेंस फ्रॉम डेलीगेट्स फ्रॉम पीपल हु कम फॉर द सिनेमा सम ये शो.
कंगना, वी सॉ सिमरन टुडे, वेरी नाइस मूवी, ग्रेट वर्क. ओके, गैंगस्टर की बात की आपने, आपने कहा बहुत ही ज्यादा मेहनत की थी आपने, बट आदित्य पंचोली का कहना है कि उनकी वजह से आपको ये फिल्म मिली, कुछ कहना चाहेंगे?
I think we have spoken enough about it, and there is nothing that I can only repeat.
Yeah, well,
things here, so you can Google it and find out.
We were told Kangana, before the session started that Kangana will be dropping quite a few bombs, N bomb, H bomb, A bomb, you know, quite a few them. I'm glad we stuck to the future of the heroine, which is the overall summit theme, which is the future of film.
Okay, thank you very much,
Kangana. It's a big day for you, and I hope you do really well. Thank you. Cheers. I will check it out in the evening. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mayank. Thank you, Kangana, for this session. Right, ladies and gentlemen, and the photographic frenzy.